You're listening to The Place We Find Ourselves, the podcast where we talk about all things story, trauma, therapy related, and also have the privilege of hearing some real life stories of interview guests. I'm Adam Young, and this is episode 11, Why Trauma Makes It Hard to Trust Your Gut. This is an important topic. In today's episode, my friend Janet shares a critical story from her life. And anytime you do something vulnerable like this, you're taking the risk of not knowing what people will do with your story. So as you listen, I'd simply ask you to consider, what does it mean to hold with honor the story of another human being whom you do not know? And how can you receive Janet's story with both a sense of sacredness and gratitude? I am glad you're listening to this conversation with Janet.
So I was, the first time I started to wonder about a story, I was in my late 30s. I was feeling very much overwhelmed by the circumstances of my life with my marriage. We had young kids. We had just taken in two teenage foster kids from another culture. And I was absolutely overwhelmed and I felt like I was going crazy. I remember feeling that and going like, I need help. And so that was the first time that I went to see a counselor, which was a big deal for me because part of my story is just the like seeing what counseling and specifically mental illness and everything, just I was profoundly affected by that as a young girl and really I would say all the way up. And so every part of me didn't want that to be me. So it was a big deal that I went to see a counselor. And as we began to talk, you know, about these things that I thought were just, well, if I could just figure out these external circumstances, everything would be okay. I began to see, you know, maybe there was something about my family story that was continuing to impact me that was worth looking at. And so, you know, I began the process of both individual counseling, then being introduced to more story work in kind of a group context and kind of being asked to consider more of naming kind of more of the reality. And I remember that, like that, when you talk about obstacles, like that for me was pretty significant because in my family, we didn't talk about what was really going on. And so to begin to name anything other than the story that my family told, which was all perfect and lovely and nothing wrong, would not please people. And so that's what I had grown up doing, is making sure I pleased everyone. So that felt significant. The other pretty significant obstacle for me was just the awareness as I began to, you know, look more and answer questions, seeing how much it was disturbing to me, how much I didn't know. So the things that I did know and the things that I didn't know. And again, something that I had learned very well was, you know, if you don't have proof, then it must not be true. And so that felt like a pretty significant obstacle. It must not be true because otherwise I would have this very clear photographic memory of everything that felt hard.
So given the culture just of your family that you grew up in, simply exploring your story was an act of defiance.
Absolutely. You didn't do that.
No. So why did you?
Really, because I knew somewhere deep inside of me that I wanted more. I wanted more for me. I wanted more for my marriage. I wanted more particularly for my children. I was so committed to their experience not being what mine had been. And so I had to, everything in me was compelled, like I have to do this.
And as you began to explore it, scared, what were you feeling? What were the initial explorations like? What did it stir in you?
Oh, scared. Yes. Often, panic. I remember actually the first time that I had a panic attack and I didn't even know what that was one time in a particularly, probably one of the first like really difficult, like I had just started to get to some difficult things in counseling. And I remember my counselor having to call and cancel because of a family emergency. And I remember like hanging up the phone and literally not being able to breathe because it was like, you don't understand. I need this. So like I began to feel it in my body, like how much was at stake. And I think one of the other things that I experienced, so like from the very beginning of our relationship, like my husband, Chris, was really the first person who had really believed me and believed what life was like in my family and had really stood up for me there. And so he was very supportive. And at the same time, as I began to engage more with my story and remember more and feel more, like it had a huge impact on him and was very disruptive. And I can remember particularly the moment where I asked him if he would be willing to come with me to talk about some of those dynamics and how they played out in our marriage. And he was like, well, I don't need to do that. I mean, I'm an easygoing person, which is, if you knew him, is so not true. I'm an easygoing person. Like there isn't anything that I need help with, but I'm absolutely supportive of you going. Like that's great. You go get all the help you need. And so there was some additional, I really think, courage on my part that was needed in saying, this is worth doing just for me. I need to do this. I want to do this.
And you mentioned not just counseling, but story groups or story work, I think you said. Can you say more? What do you mean by that?
So I think like probably, I don't know what the percentage is, you could probably tell me, a huge percentage of people I've come to recognize start to do some, you know, get a little bit of help with kind of their feeling out of control or whatever, and go, oh, I want someone else to feel this. And so I went to the group that my counselor told me about that was going on at our church. It had just started. It was, you know, our local version of a journey group. Which is a group where in community, you have an opportunity to begin to explore your stories of harm. And I remember reading the description and going, well, this isn't me. Like, I don't have a story of abuse. I mean, I just kind of have a dysfunctional family. But if I go to this, I could learn how to help other people because I've experienced how awesome it is to have somebody with me in that. So I could do that for other people. That would be great. Like I don't want anyone to not experience that. So it was not long. It was probably the second night that I sat in that group and listened to kind of clues for, you know, if these things are true of you, there might be more. And I was undone. Things that I had, even in, you know, the little bit of counseling I had done, had never considered all of these things that body symptoms and things that I had always attributed and had been attributed for me to, you know, my high sensitivity. Maybe there was more to it. Even the fact, I remember one of them particularly being about the fact that there were large periods of time that you don't remember, thinking, oh, maybe that's not just, you know, I'm dumb and I don't remember, but there's a reason that I don't remember. So that was really both at the same time, like very disturbing and validating. So I began my personal, like exploring my own story first, and really found like a place where like this is an important part of who I am and who I am meant to be and what I am to be about. And so I began like right after I finished that first group, pursuing more training and getting involved at both a local and a national level and doing that work for the next, I mean, it's been 14 years.
And so, you know, your kind of the clicking that happened inside as you're in this group and you're like, something in you is like, yes, this matters. Given the family that you grew up in, like you were an anomaly.
Oh, yes. It was very clear. I was the odd one out. And it was, I mean, so we had a family of five kids, mom and dad. And I felt like the one, you know, that one of these things does not belong. That was me.
Yes. And you didn't belong in part because you seemed to be very committed, at least in your 30s, to opening your eyes to what was true.
Yes.
So that must have taken a lot of courage.
You know, it's interesting, that word. I've really wrestled with that word. And I've come to embrace it. Initially, I really wanted to push it away because it would imply, because there's goodness and strength in it. And it has taken so long to undo all of the messages that said none of that was present. And yes, it absolutely did. Mm-hmm. I think at the time I felt like there were no other options. Mm-hmm. And yet even the fact that I don't know if this makes sense, but like my belief that there were no other options were because I was so committed to things being different for me and for my family.
That's a great sentence. That's a great sentence. Unpack that sentence.
So I think it's a, there's a way that I think I have learned to dismiss my story, to dismiss, you know, even the intentionality of my actions as just, well, I didn't have any other choice. Mm-hmm. You know, or I was desperate, you know, if I hadn't done that, you know, whatever. And in that dismissing, missing again, that place where I know at the deepest part of me, there is a very clear awareness of what I want, who I am, what I know to be right. And when I listen to that, I can access courage. Like mm-hmm. it's natural. It's me. It's who I am. Uh-huh. And I was trained to dismiss that. I remember Dan Allender saying, this was a fundamental statement for me, saying to me, you are a woman of profound truth and your family has forced you to be a liar. And so for me, moving into my story has really been about believing that that is true, that I am a woman of profound truth. And what if I actually believed that truth myself and moved from that truth and acted on it and spoke it?
Mm-hmm. And even as a young girl, it was because you were a young girl who was interested in truth that you were such a threat to your family.
Oh, yes. Absolutely. And so I think back to how many things I noticed that, again, where that part of me that was sensing and feeling and seeing what was really true in this environment where there was a very intentional like whitewashing of the truth. Like we can't let anyone see that because then it would appear like we don't have everything all together. And so I would say the things that I was seeing and noticing, and it earned me a lot of hatred from my siblings because there were ways that I used that to try and, you know, make myself like seen and noticed and important that would be about getting them in trouble. So that's annoying, right? Like you don't want to be that person. And it also, for my, you know, my parents, their response was very much, very consistent. You're just too sensitive. You know, you're going to have to figure that out on your own. It's not really that bad. All kinds of, you know, forms of that. And some of the things that, some of the scenes that I've looked at and some of the dynamics, seeing the ways that both of my parents maneuvered and manipulated and changed what they did because I believe they were afraid of what I knew has been a really important awareness.
Yes.
Does that make sense?
It does. The dilemma with that, of course, is that as a young girl, as a teenager, your parents were intimidated by you, by your commitment to truth, to see and to name.
Yeah. And so as a young girl, you know, they still had the power to silence me, and they did. I did not have resources that called out the part of me that was truest and that knew the truth and gave me the courage to speak it. I needed to survive. And so they succeeded in silencing me. And I believe you when you say that's true because of how I've watched as an adult what speaking the truth, you know, the end result of that has been in their response and lack of relationship and the kind of the consequences, if you name this. So,
yes. You have agreed generously, graciously to read one of your stories from your growing up years. So would now be a good time for you to read that?
Sure. If I had to use two words that captured a majority of my childhood experiences, they would be fear and shame. I remember feeling from a very young age that there was something wrong with me, that I was clearly different from my siblings or classmates, and that different was not good. My shame was tied to my body and a sense of humiliation about how it did and did not function. I wet the bed consistently through late elementary school, so humiliation and shame were very familiar companions. I remember an endless number of visits to doctors, invasive tests, all of the huge diaper-like products I had to wear, tracking my success and failure on reward charts, secret instructions to my friends' moms before sleepovers. I hated all of it. On this particular day, I was, I think, probably 7 or 8 years old, and I was having a test where they pumped my bladder full of fluid to the point of discomfort, and then they take a series of images. And I imagine that was an attempt to pinpoint my lack of capacity or ability to control the urge to release. It is a long, uncomfortable, stressful procedure, and I've had it done as an adult. So, like, I've experienced again that how stressful that procedure is, and there's a high probability of having a really embarrassing accident. The nurse who was with me that day was friendly and really kind of playful. And she put me at ease as much as was possible as I shivered in that cold radiology room. She told me what a brave girl I had been when we were done and presented me with this huge plastic syringe she had used for my test, suggesting with a grin that it would make a great water gun. So her words called to the mischievous, playful girl that was in me, the one who was getting lost by that time in all of the anxiety and stress of my family. So I remember on the way home, I asked my mom if I could surprise my dad when he came home from work that day and blast him with water. Like, waiting for my dad to return from work was a regular occurrence for me. I was daddy's girl, and so I watched for him. And so I remember the anticipation being so exciting as I stood. We had this big picture window that looked right out over the driveway, and I watched for his truck to come up the drive. And I remember laughing as I shot him and watched the surprise on his face, replaced very quickly with anger as he demanded, "What the Sam Hill do you think you're doing? I'm soaked." I don't remember what my mom said or did. I just remember her being there kind of in the background in the kitchen. That's where she usually was. I don't remember any offer of comfort. I do remember being very scared. I apologized over and over, another behavior I had learned well in an attempt to try and keep the peace. I tried to explain, telling my dad that the nurse had assured me it would be fun. And I had even done the right thing and asked my mom for permission first. I so desperately needed my father's love. And in that moment, I felt the very real fear of jeopardizing any chance for that with my own foolish behavior. This experience became another piece of evidence that suggested that the wisest course of action would be to follow the rules, not draw any attention to myself, and do whatever was necessary to please those that I couldn't afford to lose connection to. This survival strategy has been costly in my relationships. My recovery work has brought me face to face with the reality that I am willing to suffer much in relationships for the littlest bit of connection. And under that, there's this belief that I really, really shouldn't and can't hope for anything more because I'm lucky to get any connection.
Thank you for reading and sharing the story. There's the shame of wetting your bed. But then for you, you had to do a lot of things because you wet your bed. I mean, there was the doctor visits, the diapers that you mentioned, the reward charts, you know, where you're monitoring your how you're doing, your mom having to call other kids. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's these things that in the hearing of it feel like too much for an elementary school age girl to bear. What was it like having to do all that stuff?
I really felt, I think I most often felt very helpless. I can remember, you know, that reward chart, which I hated and was so motivated by. Yes. I mean, so there's something in that that works, right? Because if I got a certain number of dry nights in a row, then I would get taken to the corner store to buy a candy bar, which we were never allowed to have. So that was huge. and what I believed when I failed about myself and the fact that I would never get this right. And this was further evidence of what was so profoundly wrong with me. Was really hard. And I think the other thing that I was very aware of, again, in this culture of secrecy and silence in my family was, I mean, clearly the rest of my family knew what was going on. I mean, I shared bedrooms with my sisters. So, you know, they would see the disruption, you know, of all of the kind of physical having to change sheets and do the diapers and all of that. So they knew. So there's this sense, there's this shame that everyone knows such a shameful thing about me. And yet no one's talking about it. There's no like normalizing, like it's not a big deal. And so in that, I was even more sure that this has to stay hidden because, and this is a huge, it felt like it touched every part of my life. And if anyone else outside of my family knew this, they would have even more reason to see why I was so flawed.
Yeah. And you mentioned embodied, how this was so embodied. The sense of your body is almost proving that there's something wrong with you every third or fourth night.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. Because if I was like everyone else, I would be able to control this. Mm-hmm.
And so in the midst of all of that shame, in the midst of the fear of this procedure, the scariness of just having medical procedures, not to mention mm-hmm. one that's about this thing that is wrong with me that I can't fix. I mean, in the midst of all this, this nurse enters and she is kind and she knows that she sees you. She knows that this is hard for you and she knows how awful this procedure is. What's it like for you experiencing this nurse?
Again, I think I am very connected to what that felt like as a young girl because of what it's felt like as an adult woman. I've experienced both then and now what a tremendous gift and relief it is to have someone see you and be so attuned to what, you know, to the fear and the anxiety and all of that. And with their whole presence, just bring a level of calm. I think her playfulness, both her kindness and her playfulness were so different from what I was used to experiencing. And what, like, we respond to, right? And so I loved it. I absolutely loved it. I would have done anything for her. One of the things that has given me the most solid belief, I think, in the goodness of Jesus in my story is for all of the places where I was so profoundly disconnected and alone, seeing how many moments and many of them were just moments. They weren't like long-term relationships, but all of these moments that you can't explain any other way where a person brings that kind of kindness and connection enough that I can bear it and continue. And she was one of those.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And she names you and blesses you at the end as brave.
Yeah.
And then she invites the playful side of you out by basically provoking your imagination to imagine mm-hmm. using this syringe, which is, you know, has been associated with pain and yuck mm-hmm. to right. as a water gun.
Right.
And your imagination kicks in and you begin envisioning squirting your dad, you know, when he yeah. drives in the truck home, which you always are there when he drives the truck home, but now there's going to be a twist because you've got this syringe.
Yes. And like, even in that, like, so, you know, part of being a highly sensitive person and part of what I've come to bless is knowing that part of that is like this rich imagination. So like recovering some of that place in me as a very young girl that I know was there. And so, yes, my imagination absolutely picked up on that and said, I can do something fun with that. And it was already tempered with, but I need to be careful. And so I asked for permission.
Yes.
Like I look at the number of things I asked for permission for. I'm like, why did I ask permission first? Why didn't I just do that? Mm-hmm. But that like that I had learned by then that it would not go well if I didn't.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And so even, I mean, this nurse who you connect with, who means she was a moment in your story, but meant a lot to you. You had every reason to trust her words.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But you knew well enough to know you still needed to check with your mom. And so you did. And mom says, sure. Mm-hmm. And so then you're in the picture window where you've been lots. And I love the image of you waiting for him expectantly, anticipating. And this time it's going to be a little bit different. And so, you know, the moment of really gut-wrenching heartache, as I hear the story, is that split second moment when all of that excitement and anticipation, the water's been released, it's hit your dad, and all of a sudden everything changes.
Yeah.
What was that like for you?
I think terrifying. I imagine, again, because of, I can remember, I can picture where I was standing. I can picture where my dad was. And I know that my gut would have felt like a rock had just dropped in it.
Yes.
And I think so quickly, this awareness that something, you know, so I had actually engaged this creative, playful, mischievous part of myself, and it was being rejected. Mm-hmm. So that, like the something that I actually felt good about and not shame about, that was also bad. Mm-hmm. That's not good because it's resulted in my dad's anger. Mm-hmm. So I felt incredibly foolish.
Mm-hmm. And there's the essence of shame is not just a sense of there's something wrong with me, but really the core of it is there is a moment where you're expecting goodness and connection and yes. sweetness. And it's in that moment that everything turns.
Yeah.
So your mother was there. Mm-hmm. Can we talk a bit about your mother being there?
Sure.
So here are two kind of things that I heard you say. One is you asked your mom for permission and she said yes. Mm-hmm. And the other is that when your dad blew up at you, your mom was there. Mm-hmm. How have you made sense of that?
So, you know, when I was thinking about this story, again, the part of me that begins to doubt my memory and the validity of it says, well, I don't remember exactly what she did. So maybe she did. But then I go, okay, so what do I know to be true of other interactions? I know what I experienced often, there were other scenes that I have where, you know, my dad would be playing with me in a way that would end up with me, like it usually involved tickling mercilessly. And it was torture for me. And would also usually end up in wetting myself. Mm-hmm. And once in a while, it would get to the point where if I screamed long enough, my mom would call from the kitchen, Fred! And I think what I believe that if she had stepped in a significant way and brought comfort, I would remember that. Mm-hmm. What she did more often was, I think, a very intentional, do what is necessary to make it appear like you are providing some sort of protection so that she couldn't be tried.
Yeah, hence the half-hearted Fred from the other
yes,
room.
Yes, exactly.
She's being a mother.
Yes. So how can you say, like, I was there. Mm-hmm. I was there. And she has said that to me. I did the best I could. And there was no comfort.
Mm-hmm. Right. And she either was surprised that your father got upset or she wasn't.
She was not surprised. I absolutely believe that to be true. She chose for her own protection to live in her own reality and deny what was true. And in that, she very much sacrificed me mm-hmm. to my father.
It's a good word because you asked permission. Mm-hmm. And she didn't say, honey, I'm not sure that's a good idea. I mean, if she had given you the slightest bit of doubt.
Yeah, I wouldn't have never have done it.
No way.
I was so obedient.
Yes. She not only said yes, but she said a hearty yes. And you came to life with excitement.
Mm-hmm. And I believe because of, again, the amount of work that I've done in scenes like this and others. I mean, this scene became one of the very pivotal scenes in finally putting together, kind of connecting enough dots to to finally look at really my sexual harm from at the hands of my father and my mother's not only awareness of that, but her participation in that. And so I do believe that, I mean, his anger was not unusual. So if she knew him at all, she would know that would be his response.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. She set you up for his fury, not just for his fury, but she knew that you waited in the window for him to come home. And that this was a moment, a good moment of your day, his arrival. So I guess what I'm getting at is just the cruelty of it is immense. The setup.
Yeah, that's a good word. It was a word that was really hard for me to begin to associate with my mom and a lot of her actions, because the way, again, in our family culture, the way I was taught to view her and relate to her was, you know, this fragile woman that we had to work very hard to protect and not expect too much of and kind of feel sorry for. So beginning to engage with where she actively moved to place me in harm's way. Cruelty is a good word. Mm-hmm.
What does one do with data that suggests mom's kind of fragile on the one hand, and on the other hand, she has so much agency and intentionality in this story that this is not a weak or powerless woman.
Mm-hmm. What you do is you decide you're crazy. I'm the crazy one.
Which, if I'm hearing you right, in so many ways became one of the fundamental wars of not just your heart, but your path of engaging your story.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because you don't know if you can trust your own heart, your own knower, your own gut.
Right. Absolutely.
How did you win that war?
Well, I haven't won it yet. I am winning it. So, there were certainly moments. I mean, like the moment that I said earlier about, you know, Dan naming this thing about, you know, being a woman of profound truth, that was at a women's recovery week. And during that same week, like he named for me, he called it my knower and really blessed that and invited me to bless that. And it didn't happen right away. And yet just in having that named, I can remember so many times, again, that deep place in me, where as that is named, that knower in me rests and breathes and said, yes, this is true. Everything in me knows this is true and trustworthy. So I think it's only that has only been like in the last six years or so that I've been engaging at that level with my story and really coming to trust more, to pay attention for that part of, to pay attention to that part of me, to have, you know, kindness for my knowing, because it's not always, not often a good knowing, right? And so there's a lot of care that's needed in some of what I know. And yet the more that I have done that and blessed that, I have, like, all of my life, like, fear was such a big part of my reality. And really fundamentally, I didn't believe that I could survive on some level. And yet what I found as I really blessed this knowing place in me and lived, I think, out of a truer identity, words like courage began to feel more true and not just a one-time anomaly. Things that I had always been sure would overwhelm me and completely undo me, and so they were to be avoided at all costs, I walked into, you know, hard conversations, conflict, allowing myself to really fully feel emotions to the point where I would feel like I was drowning. And it passed and I came through and I was still okay. And so I think there's been kind of a level of like building trust in myself that's been huge.
In many ways, that's the redemption of the assault against your heart that was so pervasive in your growing up years. I mean, the assault against your word, your knower.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I want to transition a bit to, you know, one of the themes that's come out in so many of these interviews is how a story like this, which I know it's representative of other stories, but a story like this, 30 seconds of your life, can lead to ways of relating to other people that endure for decades and that cost us a lot. And so in your story, there was the sense that if you make a mistake by shooting your dad with a water gun, you might lose your father's love.
Yes.
And so that's a graceless world that you lived in. Mm-hmm. And at the end of your story, you spoke of how the bind you were in was you can either have relational connection, some morsel of it, and endure the contempt of others, or you can say, you know, no, this is not right, and lose relationship.
Right.
That seems to be one of the core binds of your life as a little girl.
Absolutely.
And so there's only one way for that bind to be resolved for a little girl, because little girls, like little boys, children need relational connection. We have to have it. And so you began to endure and accept contempt and cruelty in exchange for some measure of connection. Mm-hmm. And that has cost you a lot. Mm-hmm. Can relational tendencies like that really develop from a couple minutes of your life?
Yes. And so, you know, that was a couple minutes in that scene. And I had so many moments like that. And so I think there's something about the cumulative effect.
Yes.
That was necessary. There needed to be a lot to really silence that knower. Mm-hmm. And so I think, for a long time. So as I began to enter, you know, in my story, so, you know, the first kind of obvious relationships to look at that cost was with my parents. And so I think for a long time, I hated that little girl. I hated how desperately she needed her daddy. And it took a long time to see the goodness of that desire for love.
Yes.
And it came, and that awareness that the twisting and the harm that came was very separate from that desire for love. Like, that's good. There's only goodness in that. What has been more difficult and feels like the place where I have been spending more of my time in the last couple of years has been seeing how that has translated into other relationships, particularly friendships. But really the same, I mean, it's hard to see, because it's easy to look at, you know, my parents and some of their actions and go, like, clearly there was, you know, some level of, you know, evil and harm at work. So, like, I can get on board with, you know, that being unhealthy. To look at a relationship, a friendship, it takes more work for me to trust what I know and what I'm experiencing, and to name, wait a minute, something is not right here, to believe that I actually have something of worth and value just in who I am in the relationship. Mm-hmm. And so this pattern that, you know, I'll endure suffering for the littlest bit of connection has been something that I'm looking at a number of relationships where I think it's funny. I turned 50 this year, and I feel like as a 50-year-old woman, I am finally, like, giving myself permission to engage in friendships simply for the joy of, like, delighting in someone else and allowing them to delight in me, for believing that's possible.
Yes.
For believing it's good, for not feeling this obligation to have to measure my worth or value or what I bring in order to be enough for them to consider that I'm worth having as a friend. Like, all of that feels like very new and tender space for me. And so that place where I can remember when my counselor talked about kind of this pattern and, you know, the reality that Like, we don't consciously, you know, reenact, you know, this bind, but that some part of us chooses that in order to hopefully come up with a different result. That was mind blowing to me.
Yes,
it really was. And it was very sobering because it's like, okay, so as an adult woman, I do have responsibility and I'm aware of this now. And so what do I want to do with that? Do I want to keep ignoring what I know and to be true? And, you know, approaching relationships from a position of less than and shame? Or am I committed to really mutual delight and trust? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's been very different. Mm-hmm. And it feels really vulnerable. Mm-hmm. So there are days and exchanges where it goes well. And there are days and exchanges and moments where it feels absolutely foolish.
There's two things I want to return to. First was your words about reenacting really some of the core patterns that we learned growing up in our adult relationships. And there's something about that that is true and that is absolutely maddening.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it is very easy to either rage at God or rage at ourselves that this happens. Like, how could this happen in my friendships when I had to bear the misery of this happening growing up?
Yeah. So for me, it has always been much easier to rage at myself. Mm-hmm. And so that is a place where the inner critic in me is loud about with a lot of accusation. Mm-hmm. Oh, surely this is my fault. This is because of who I am. And so, you know, any kind of betrayal, even it really, I shouldn't expect any better.
Right. Which I think is how your story ended.
Yeah. So the even beginning to see that pattern. So I think one of the things that feels like it's kind of what you're getting at. So, you know, going through a really significant betrayal and rupture in relationship a few years ago, and then in the last year, feeling like it was happening all over again with someone else, that voice was loud about you knew the truth and yet the same thing is happening. So why are you here again? Why are you here again? Mm-hmm. And having tremendous contempt for being here again.
Yes. And I guess this is more a personal comment than you can say if it's true for you or not. But the self-contempt for me in those moments protects me from seeing and feeling the horror of the betrayal.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Yes. I believe that's very true. Because and partly, I don't know if this makes sense, but I think part of my, on some level, refusal to feel the horror of the betrayal means that then I would connect with that fuller knowing of what was really true, and I would then be faced with, and so what will I do with this? And that would be likely to end up in losing a relationship. So again, I'll be alone.
And so maybe, you know, just to state what has become so increasingly clear in all of these interviews, the core dilemmas of our growing up years become reenacted over and over and over in our adult lives, in our marriages, in our close relationships, in the stories of our adult lives.
Yes, I believe that is true.
And ultimately, that drama forces us to deal with God in very close quarters. If we let it.
Yes. Right. If we let it. And I think that, you know, as I listen to you say that, there's something so important. I mean, on some level, there's like a really, really we're here again. And yet it's like, it's that place where I picture like this wild Jesus saying, yes, we are here again, because this is your opportunity to actually experience something redemptive. Mm-hmm. And if we weren't here again for you to experience that, I don't know that I would recognize it. And so there's something about the familiarity of it and then seeing a redemptive, different, transformed possibility that I don't know I would see it if it wasn't familiar. Does that make sense?
It does. And it points to what seems to be the agonizing truth that God is very committed to both healing and maturing us, growing us up. making us more solid versions of ourselves.
Yes. Yeah. I like that word solid. I mean, that like solid, grounded, stable.
And the dilemma with that, of course, is that's what got you in trouble with your family.
Mm-hmm. And continues to.
Yeah.
Yes.
So there is a whole podcast in unpacking those two sentences, but we won't do that now. I just want to maybe end on this note. You mentioned earlier that you had some measure of hatred for, you would probably say, the neediness of that girl who was so desperate for her father's love. But one of the kindest parts of the story, as you told it, for me, was just when you simply confessed and read without contempt in your voice, "I so desperately needed my father's love." So you seem to be more at peace now with how much that girl longed for her father as she stood in the picture window. Mm-hmm. How has that come to shift for you, your heart posture towards her desperate longing for her father's love?
So I think it has been a significant shift. And it happened, I think, over a period of time. It happened, I think, really because of having the invitation to consider that young part of me was still there and was worthy of attention and care and kindness. And so that I was really the only one equipped to bring that. And so as I began to do that, and I can remember the first time being like, this is weird. Like, I don't know how to do this. But, and I don't think I can't even put words to what it's like when it happens. But there is something about bringing the care and comfort she needed that allowed, like, all of me to more fully settle in, like, that needing love. I mean, it's fundamental to who we are. It is innocent and right and natural and true and good. And it's who I am. I mean, it's at the core of who I am. And so believing that and blessing that has allowed me to settle as I look back at interactions, you know, with my father for sure, and even other people, as there was goodness there. There was goodness there. And there were even moments where I believe he delighted in that in good ways. And he is responsible for the things he brought to that that were not goodness. That rests on him.
As you talked about the girl's need for her father's love, the sense I had is you've become the nurse for her.
Yeah, that's a good picture. I like that picture.
And, you know, I don't care how weird that sounds. It is what she needed. It is what she needs. And you have, for some reason, you have found more courage to be kind to her rather than cursing her for the fact that she happens to be created in the image of a triune God who needs love to give and to receive love.
Yes. Yeah. I think I love that image. And I would say I'm having so much fun, like, going back and, like, especially when I find certain pictures, like, looking for that playful, mischievous, delightful little girl, going, wow, she is so, so worth delighting in.
Yes. Yeah. Well, that is a lovely note to end on. So I want to say truly thank you, not just for the story, but for your vulnerability today in reflecting on really the heartache that was this story for you.
You are most welcome.
Thanks for listening. If you are wanting to engage your story at a deeper level, I have 3 resources on my website that are designed to help with that. One is about how to write a story. Another is about the 6 things that every child needs from their parents. And the third is about attachment. You can access those documents by going to adamyoungcounseling.com, click on any podcast episode, and then just scroll down a bit and they will be there in red. Take care. See you next week.